A blessed day to you, brethren. You are welcome to this broadcast, this beautiful day that the Lord has blessed us. And our prayer from BSM TV is that you will truly be blessed with the message that is coming to us today. This beautiful day, the Lord has given us a topic which is saying, what are you hearing? What are you hearing? That is the topic for today, and we want to delve into the Word of God to discover, is there something that we need to hear from God? Is there something that we need to hear that is of benefit to us as a people? In order for us to truly appreciate the word hearing, because that will be the center of our topic, to say, what are you hearing? So we want to understand the word hear. The Bible has given in many scriptures the word hear. It is a word that has to do with action, and we want to look at some of the Bible scriptures that are giving us this word and how it can be applied in our life today. In Matthew chapter 11 verse 15, we see Christ our Savior speaking to the disciples of John, and also to his own disciples, using the word hear. In this picture, the disciples of John had come to Jesus, and remember, at that time John was in prison, and he sent his disciples to go and find out whether the one who was preaching as Christ the Messiah was truly the one that he had proclaimed. And in verse 15 of Matthew chapter 11, we see Jesus speaking to them when they came to inquire, is this the Christ that John had been waiting for? Jesus says to them, go and tell John what you hear and what you see. Go and tell John what you hear and what you see. So there is something that Christ was pointing to them that they must hear, so that once they heard, they should have proof. They should have the confidence that truly this was the Christ. And at the same time, further down in the scriptures, he speaks to the disciples concerning the same John as the Elijah who was supposed to come. And he beckoned them. He says, he who has an ear, let him hear. He who has an ear, let him hear. That was Jesus, emphasizing on the need to hear, so much that once they heard, they needed to put an action to it. That is the word hear. In the book of Psalms, we see David in Psalms chapter 4, talking to God, asking God for a blessing. But how does he ask God for a blessing? He says, hear my cry, oh my God. Hear my cry, oh my God. Hear me when I call, O God of my righteousness. Thou hast enlarged me when I was in distress. Have mercy upon me. Hear my prayer. That was David emphasizing the need that he had that God should hear his prayer. We are living in a world of sounds. We are living in a world where so much is being talked, so much music is being played, so much noise everywhere, but we need to hear. There's something that we need to hear, brethren. Let's go to Ezekiel, the prophet Ezekiel, in Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 4. Ezekiel 37, verse 4 is a different scenario where now God is speaking to Ezekiel, the prophet, in a valley of bones. He is brought in the spirit in a valley of bones. Now these bones are not fresh bones, they are dead, dry bones. And we read that, again he said unto me, son of man, prophesy unto these dry bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Here's a man of God being asked to listen to the sound, to listen to tell the bones to listen to the word of God, to the sound that would be made at that particular moment. Hear the word of the Lord. What would happen? Thus saith the Lord unto these dry bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. So, for the bones to receive life, they needed to hear the word of God. So, to hear is an active word. It is an active word. It demands action. So, when the bones heard the word of the Lord, did they receive life, brethren? Yes, they did. We see that hearing is very, very important. And so it is. When we hear the word of the Lord coming to us, especially now in our time, we need to pay attention so that we hear and do that which the word comes to tell us, so that we can have life. We understand that there's power in hearing. There's power in hearing. And once we make it a point that we pray to God and ask God to help us hear his voice, we will receive the power of God and we'll be able to do great exploits for God. We will not fail. We will overcome every temptation that comes our way. We will know the will of God in our lives, but we need to hear the voice of God. Because when we say hearing, it means that there's somebody that is speaking. And we know from Amos chapter 3, verse 7, God says that he does nothing except he reveals his secrets to his prophets. In our time, we are looking for the voice of God and we want to hear the voice of God. But how shall we hear the voice of God? Somebody has to speak. And so we need to look out and hear that voice so that we can be able to do that which God wants us. So our topic today is saying, what are you hearing? What are we hearing, brethren? We are going to look at Daniel chapter 3 and see in that chapter how we can be helped as a people in our time to hear the voice of God. In Daniel chapter 3 is a story of the fiery furnace and the three Hebrew boys. I know when we talk about the fiery furnace, it's a common lesson for everyone. In many podias, in many forums, this lesson has been talked about, the fiery furnace. Oh, there was fire and the three boys were cast into the without really digging deeper to understand what is it that God is talking to us about. And the question has come, what are you hearing? What are we hearing? So, in the last presentations that we have had on this channel, we have had powerful lessons on Daniel chapter 2, where Daniel revealed, God gave him a revelation of the dream which King Nebuchadnezzar had concerning his kingdom. And in Daniel chapter 2, we had an exploration of the word of God concerning how the kingdoms of earth will be run until his kingdom will be set up. And now Nebuchadnezzar, once he received this revelation, he forgot that he needed to hear the voice of God. What did he do? He used his own power to defy the word of God. And in chapter 3, we see Nebuchadnezzar now, you know, erecting a statue, a big monument of that same picture that God had shown him. A statue which was showing how the kingdoms would flow. But Nebuchadnezzar decided to make one of God. Oh, God! And he made a decree which he commanded all nations, everybody, to come and worship. But how did this process go about? What happened? How did he do it? So we see that in chapter 3 of Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar caused all his people, all the leaders of the nations, all the leaders of the province of Babylon. Remember that Babylon was an empire. It was a world empire. And Nebuchadnezzar called everybody that had authority to come on the day that he was to commemorate, to dedicate this statue to himself. And he made a law, a decree. A man made law to say, and he called a herald, somebody to come and proclaim before these people to tell them what to do. Yeah, he tells them, when they had gathered together before that statue. Let us go to Daniel chapter 3. In verse 1-3, Nebuchadnezzar, we see that he caused all the leaders of the province and he commanded them to come to the dedication of the of the statue. In verse 4 of chapter 3, it says that to you it is commanded, O people, nations and languages. So there we see where Nebuchadnezzar is using his authority as a king to make sure that these people that he has called understand the reason why he has called them. He said, to you it is commanded, O people, all languages of all nations, that at what time you hear the sound, in verse 5. I just want us to look at that statement there. At what time you hear the sound. If you go down, it says, you fall down and worship the golden image. This was the sound that was coming from Nebuchadnezzar. He called an herald. Now, did Nebuchadnezzar ask the people to worship him? Brethren, Nebuchadnezzar says, when you hear the sound of all manner of music, you have to do what? To fall down and worship the golden image. Now, we want to know what this image symbolized. What does this image symbolize? In the Prophets and Kings, page 506.3, we see that there's a statement there which says, not all had bowed their knee to the idolatrous symbol of human power. The statue was a symbol of human power. It was a symbol of human authority, which everybody was being called to do what? To bow, to obey. In other words, they were supposed to obey the laws of man. How do people obey? By laws. In any country, you see governments, they've got laws. And for you to be called a good citizen, you must abide by the laws. And now, here Nebuchadnezzar has made a special law which wants everybody to do what? To obey. How would they do that? He was to play music. There was a sound. He was to play music which everybody was supposed to listen to at a particular time. Do we have a particular time, brethren, when we are supposed to worship? Yes. God has a particular time that he wants us to come and worship him. Here's Nebuchadnezzar doing the same, calling people at a particular time to come and listen, to hear the sound of music. Now, you see, you will notice that this music, it was all manner of music, brethren. It was not a specific sound. It was like every kind of music. Now, I wonder how that music really came out. Because if all manner of music was to be played, that was going to cause confusion. And we know what Babylon is. It says confusion. Question that we ask. Did everybody worship? Did everybody bow their knees? No. Was this music a call to worship? Yes, it was. Did everybody come to worship? No. The Bible says there were some people, a certain Jews, not all Jews, but a certain Jews who did not hear this sound. That's why we're talking about the three Hebrew boys. There were some people who did not hear, because the decree was when you hear. So for them to remain standing, they did not hear the music. They chose not to hear the music. But the rest of the Jews heard the music and they worshipped the image. PK 506.3. The certain class of Jews, in the midst of these worshipping multitudes, we are told that there were three men who were firmly resolved not thus to dishonor the God of heaven. So we see, brethren, here, worship has to do with heaven. Worship is only reserved for God. So when Nebuchadnezzar was calling people to come and worship this statue, we are told that there were some, Prophets and Kings, page 506, there were some who resolved not thus to dishonor the God of heaven. So this music that was played was a music of worship to dishonor God. But these men chose not to dishonor God. So their God, it says that their God was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and they would bow to none other. Did they understand the voice of God? Yes, they did. So when the sound of music of Babylon was being played, a call to worship, there were some amongst the Jews who did not hear that call to worship. They chose to hear the voice of God. Now, when Nebuchadnezzar the king was told concerning this act that these young people had played, not to fall and worship the man-made laws, Nebuchadnezzar threatened them with a fiery furnace, and they testified of their allegiance to God. When Nebuchadnezzar came to threaten them, they didn't fear. They testified. The act of bowing, PK 507 says that the act of bowing to the image was understood by all as an act of worship. Such homage would only be given to God alone. So the young men who had come as captives into Babylon, they understood what it meant to kneel, to bow. It was an act of worship. So when Nebuchadnezzar called these people to worship this image, he says that they refused because they understood that that act was only supposed to be given to God. What music did they hear? Did they hear the sound of music in Exodus chapter 20, verse 2 to 6? Did they hear Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4? Did they hear Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 1 to 4? Where God had instructed Moses to speak to the children of Israel, to ask them to worship God alone, to ask them not to make any form of image, to curve, or to make, to create anything of any likeness that God had created for them to worship as gods. Did they hear that sound? Yes, they did. These Hebrew boys, brethren, had been trained. They had been trained to hear the voice of God alone. But they would not kneel to the music of Babylon, because they read in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 1, where Moses was calling upon Israel, hear the voice of the Lord, keep the statutes, keep the commandments, keep the judgments, and once you do this, you will prosper. You see that? And in Exodus, we hear God saying, I am the only God. Thou shalt not make any graven image. Thou shalt not worship any other God before me. Did they hear that voice? Yes. No wonder when the confused music came, they couldn't hear it, because they had purposed in their hearts. In Daniel chapter 1 verse 8, we see Daniel there speaking on behalf of his friends that I had purposed it in my heart not to defile my body, not to defile God, not to disobey God. That was Daniel. From the very beginning when they came to Babylon, he spoke like that. You remember? When these boys came into Babylon, the court of Babylon, to serve in the king's court, they were being trained for that purpose. It began with food, brethren. When the king commanded that all those young men who had been chosen to serve under him should be given a certain kind of diet from the king's table. Do you know what they said? They said, no, no, no. In verse 11 of Daniel, Daniel says that, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, for 10 days. Let them give us pulse and water to eat and drink. So Daniel, speaking on behalf of his friends, understood that they did not need to eat food that God had forbidden them to eat. And so they asked for pulse and water. What is pulse? Pulse is simply grains, brethren. The food of the soil, grains, legumes, and water. And he says, try us after 10 days. Come and look upon our countenance and compare us with that of the countenance of those that shall be eating from the king's table. And whatever you will see, deal with us accordingly. That was the confidence that these young men had. What a challenge. What a challenge that could be given to one who is in leadership by laymen. Daniel, by that time, he was just a simple young boy who was able to stand on the truth, who was able to speak and challenge Melza and say, give us pulse. Why? Because that's what God gave them to eat. That's what God said in Genesis. He says, eat of the grains, of the fruits, of the trees that were given in Eden. Not flesh. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 5, God, when he was calling Moses and the Israelites coming out of Egypt at the foot of Mount Sinai, he asked them, you have seen what I have done for you. I have brought you out of Egypt. I've carried you on eagle's wings. I bear you and I brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if you will hearken, will you obey? God is asking Moses, you know, to speak to the Israelites. Will you obey and keep my covenant? If you do this, you shall become a peculiar treasure unto me. God's desire when he gave Israel a peculiar diet and a peculiar lifestyle was that they become a peculiar treasure unto him in all the earth. And the people said to Moses, you can read the whole chapter of chapter 19 of Exodus. You will see the story there where they said, we shall do whatever you command us, we will do. And Moses spoke to God. Now, brethren, in verse 9, there's something there that is very critical for us to really understand. In verse 9 of Exodus chapter 19, God says to Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee and believe thee forever. That is a striking statement by God. When God called Moses and the Israelites to come to Sinai, when he was giving them the laws, he says, let them come so that when I speak to you, Moses, they will hear my voice. And when they hear my voice, that they may believe you forever. Does God want us to believe the voice of the servants that he sends us? Yes. Is it a temporal belief? No. He wants us to believe Moses forever. And Moses, when he was up there in the mountain and God was speaking to him, the Israelites heard the voice of God. They heard the voice of God, brethren, when he was speaking to Moses. And in Babylon, now we are in Babylon, and we see now these young boys who are descendants of the fathers that we are hearing the voice of God. We prove that from Nehemiah chapter 9 verse 13, where now when they came out of Babylon, they out of captivity, they were able to recall the words that God spoke to Moses in verse 13 and 14, that you came down also upon Mount Sinai and spoke unto them from heaven. The great messages that God gave to Moses concerning the judgments, the true laws, the statutes and the commandments. And it says that you made known unto them the holy Sabbath and the commandments and the precepts, the statutes and the laws by the hand of Moses thy servant. In Exodus 19 verse 9, God is saying, I want them to hear you forever. In Nehemiah, they are recalling the voice of God, which God had spoken to Moses. And they are recalling the laws that God had given. Do you see that, brethren? Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, they were a testimony to this that God had spoken, that forever. God is not lacking a people that to hear his voice, even in our time, brethren. God is not lacking, but he wants us to hear his voice. He wants us to hear his voice. What are you hearing? That is our question today. What are you hearing? Are you hearing the voice of God? Are you hearing the man-made voices? These young men were acquainted with the voice of God. They knew it so much that even when the sound of Babylon was made, it was a strange voice to them. They knew the sound of worship. They knew the Sabbath. God calls us to worship him on the Sabbath, to come and reverence him, to come and praise him, to come and worship him. These Israelites, they stood as a testimony before Nebuchadnezzar. When man-made laws are being passed, In our time, brethren, especially in this season, we are hearing the sound of worship for the world. There is a sound that is coming out. The world is calling for worship, but God has a sound. God has a sound of music that we must listen to, which these young men listened to, and they worshipped only God. They did not defy God. Let us continue. Let us look at these sounds that was played in the time of Babylon. Let us go to verse 5 of Daniel chapter 3. Look at the instruments there that were used. There was a cornet, there was a flute, there was a harp, there was a sackbut, satyry. It says down there, all kinds of music. All kinds of music. Brethren, are we hearing all kinds? Can you hear in the world? The world has all kinds of music. But in Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 4, Deuteronomy 6 verse 4, Moses is calling Israel to hear the voice of God. He says, "Hear ye, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. The Lord our God is one Lord." We can't have many voices from one Lord, only one voice. That is why, brethren, at every era of time, God has had a voice, one voice. In the time of Elijah, it was Elijah. In the time of Moses, it was Moses. When Joshua came, it was Joshua. Even Peter, even John, even Paul, these men spoke at different times. We don't need a confused voice. We don't need a multitude of voices. That is, you know, Lucifer had seven voices. He had said, my brethren, let us hear the voice of God. Lucifer, when we read, we understand that he had more than one voice when he sang. When he stood in the presence of God and he sang, we are told he had seven voices complete. When he sang, everybody enjoyed his music. Is he using that kind of music today? All harps, all flutes, all satyry, all kinds of music must play. Those that hear those kinds of music, they cannot worship God. In our time, Christ speaks to us using one voice. He will not confuse us. He will not have us confused which one. Now you can imagine, I wonder, those people were dancing. I'm sure some of them were dancing to the flute. Others were dancing to the harp. And obviously the dance was different from one another. It was different. We see it even in the world today. When music is being played around the world, there are so many dances which you wouldn't even want to look at. Some of them confused kind of worship in the world. But God is one God, and he has only one voice. When John the Baptist came before Christ to proclaim, to make straight the path in Luke chapter 3, verse 3 to 5, the word of the Lord came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He came into the country about Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sin. As it is written in the book of Isaiah the prophet, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight." This prophecy was given in Isaiah chapter 40 verse 3, where God proclaimed through Isaiah that there's a voice that will come, that will make straight the path before the Messiah comes. And we see here, brethren, how God is one God. Truly he is one God, and he does not give us a confused thought of voices. What are you hearing? What are you hearing in our time? There is a voice that we need to hear, brethren. This voice that was prophesied by Isaiah, the voice that God used during the time of John, those that listened to the voice of John, they were baptized and they received repentance and they were ready to receive the Messiah. We know that even when Christ came, it was from the disciples of John that he got some of his disciples, those that had heard the voice in the wilderness. In our time, God has a voice. The same voice has been speaking throughout the ages. He uses the same voice, brethren. The Hebrew boys, like Moses, they heard the voice. It started with diet. They heard the voice that spoke to them. God does come through, brethren, for his children. Peter was removed from the prison walls. He came out of those prison walls. And we see how God in his mercy, whenever he has promised us to say, fear not, he will always come through. It's the same happening with these Hebrew boys. We see them standing, proclaiming Christ, the Savior. They revealed truth to the people at that time, that there's a God who can save. They told of the Redeemer to come. And for that, Christ honored them. They had presented him well. They had proclaimed the truth. They presented Christ to the people. In our time, there is a voice, brethren, that is crying in the wilderness. In Malachi chapter 4, we hear there God is speaking to us through prophet Malachi. In the latter days, in the days when the world is coming to its close, there's a voice that we must listen to. The voice in Malachi chapter 4 verse 4 is saying that, remember ye the laws of Moses, which I spoke to him in Mount Horeb, concerning the laws, the commandments, the feasts, and the judgments. Are we hearing that voice in our time? There was a Herod in Daniel chapter 3. There was a Herod in verse 4. The Herod cried aloud, calling people to worship an image which was a symbol of human power. In our time, there is a Herod. There is a loud voice. Revelation chapter 18 is saying that, and he cried out mightily with a strong voice, Babylon the Great is fallen and has become the habitation of devils and the hoard of every foul spirit and the cage of every unclean bird. Do we see the similarities there, brethren? The call out of Babylon in our time is telling us that this house has become a habitation of every unclean bird. In Daniel chapter 3, we were told that the people were called to worship at every sound, all kinds of music. All kinds of music called people to worship. In Revelation 18, it says in verse 4, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. The spirit of prophecy in early writings confirms this. Page 277, we read, angels were sent to, and there was a mighty angel. There were angels that were sent to aid the mighty angel from heaven. And I heard a voice which seemed to sound from everywhere, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. There is a voice calling, brethren, to come out of Babylon, to come out of false worship, to come out so that we do not partake of her plagues. The plagues that God is going to pour upon Babylon. The plagues that God is going to give as a punishment for a people that do not hear his voice. God does not want his children to partake. And that is why he's saying, come out. Now it says this message seemed to be an addition to the third message, joining it as the midnight cry joined the second angel's message in 1844. There was a midnight cry in 1844. Behold, the bridegroom comes. There is a midnight cry. This angel of Revelation 18 is our midnight cry angel. And once this angel is heard, it means that Babylon has fallen. The world has become red. The sins of this world have reached the cup. The cup is full. The cup is full, brethren. And God wants us to come out and not partake. And he's saying, the glory of God rested upon the patient waiting saints, and they fearlessly gave the last solemn warning, proclaiming the fall of Babylon and calling upon God's people to come out of her, that they may escape the fearful doom. There is a doom that is coming. There is a doom, brethren, that is coming upon this earth. And there is a people in our time that are fearlessly proclaiming a message of coming out of Babylon. The world has become red. The last solemn call out of Babylon is a midnight cry. Are we going to hear the voice of God? Are we going to be stagnant in the dirty pools of Babylon? Brethren, it's time to come out. It's time to let go of false worship. We can hear every sound, especially now, my dear brothers and sisters. The world is calling us to worship. You can hear the sounds. It's a festive season, is it? People are preparing themselves, spending colossal sums of money, calling their relatives. Even the so-called men of God, people who are supposed to preach the truth, they are busy gathering together to worship a false god, to worship man-made laws. Come out. Come out, my brother and my sister. God's children will have a purpose in our time. God's children will have a purpose. Shadrach and his friends, Daniel and Meshach and Abednego, they purposed in their hearts. They will not worship a false god. They will not worship man-made laws. They purposed in their hearts to fear God. Shall we fear God, my brothers and my sisters? Is it our purpose? Is it our purpose today? Which voice are we hearing? Are we hearing the voice in the wilderness calling us to keep the feasts, calling us to worship God in truth and in spirit, keep the solemn feasts? In Nahum chapter 1, this is the last scripture we are reading. Behold upon the mountains the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publishes peace. O Judah, keep thy solemn feasts, perform thy vows, for the wicked shall no more pass through thee. It is utterly cut off. The wicked is utterly cut off. It's time to reform, my brethren. It's time to keep the feast of God. It's time to worship God. It's time to hear the voice of God. Let us bow our knees to our Creator, the God of the universe. He is calling us to worship Him, to come out of Babylon, because time is no longer. Hear the voice of God crying in the wilderness. Keep thy vows. Keep the feasts, brethren. Stop keeping false feasts, pagan feasts. We are in a terrible time, my brothers and sisters. Let us awake to the voice of God. Let us hear the voice of God. God wants us to worship Him. He wants to save His people. There's no other way, my brothers and sisters. This is the last call of mercy. Hear the voice of God. It is a solemn wake. It is a solemn time we are living in. We should fear God. Revelation 14 says, fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come. Worship Him who made the heavens and the earth, the seas and the fountains. God calls us to worship. How should we worship God? By keeping His commandments, by keeping the statutes, by keeping the feasts. There's no other way, brethren. Keep thy solemn feasts. Keep thy vows, O Judah. Hear the voice of one who is coming. There's someone whose feet are the Lord's feet. Whose feet are the Lord's feet. Who is publishing peace. Not the peace that the world is giving. The peace that is being published is the peace that comes from God, which is found only as we keep God's commandments. I beseech you, my brothers, this day, to hear the voice of God. What are you hearing? May God bless us this day as we choose to hear the voice of God, as we purpose in our hearts to proclaim without fear the word of the Lord. May God bless you. Shalom.
BSN TV. the channel which provides meat in due season.